to all. All who call upon you, you will rescue and forgive. This is why I live. You lived the life I could never live. You died the death, oh, that I deserve. You rose to life and now you live. That's how you forgive me. In your mercy, I'm unworthy of your love. You rose to life and now I live, I live, I live, I live.
You live the life I could never live. You died the death, oh, that I deserve. You rose to life and now you live. That's how you forgive. The measure of your love. You came and died for us. Let us not forget. That's how you
Well, good morning. I actually said good morning last night. That's the hardest thing on Saturday night. Your brain is thinking Sunday morning, and it's not. So we're glad to have you here this morning. Just a couple of announcements. Ladies Bible study called All Things New is going to meet four Tuesdays in April, beginning April 9th, and there's information out in the foyer. This is exciting because starting next week, we're going to have a basics belief course. It's going to start at 8:30 on Sunday morning. This is designed to a 10-week study of basic theology would be the technical word, but it's what does it mean to be a believer? What are the truths of Scripture that we need to understand? What is man, creation, sin, salvation, those topics. And so if you've never taken a theology course at the college level, I would suggest that you sign up and be a part of that. It's going to be taught by John Locke, Justin Cousins, right? And a number of myself and some others. And so it's going to be an exciting thing to be a part of. Ultimately, we're going to be adding classes. We're really hoping that everybody eventually takes all of the courses, but that starts next week. I'm also really excited to let you know that in Tuesday the 18th at Scroon Lake Central School, Essex County Health Department is having a community conversation, and its focus is youth mental health and addiction recovery. And Mountainside Celebrate Recovery is supplying the refreshments. Pastor Lyle's actually been invited to be on the panel. And so we need too many cookies than CR group can make. And so we need you to help by making cookies or brownies. And there's information out there, information on Facebook, so you can prepare this. But I would suggest you come. I've been to two of them. I went to Lake Placid and Moriah, and it's really informative about how the mind develops, the brain develops across childhood. Maybe you'll ever ask the question, why did my child do that? They'll have some answers. And it's just important to be a part of the community and to even get a glimpse of the needs of our community. And so I would just challenge you to be a part of that. We're very excited that Celebrate Recovery is starting to be recognized in Essex County Health Department, our Celebrate Recovery. So and then also, this announcement for July 6th, but we want you to respond by April 28th. Siegel Festival is going to do Brigadoon, which is some of the most beautiful music, and we're planning to go to the matinee show. This is focusing on the Abide group, those that are of us that are older. We'd like to get group seating, which is a discount. It's $45 for the seat. It's an afternoon showing, but we'd like to secure group seats now. I mean, you could sign up later, but it's selling out fast because this is such a popular one. So if you want to be a part of that, we'd love to have you. All information on all those things is out in the lobby, and so and it's along with the offering box. Most of our church family gives online, so if you'd like to give online, we would appreciate that, or you can give into the box outside. Pastor Lyle's away. They're on vacation, coming back today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin this service. Father, we are so grateful that you love us, that you are patient with us, that you are kind to us, though we often are impatient with you. We often walk away from you, make choices that don't glorify you, and yet, as you say over and over and over to Israel through the prophets, just come back. So, Father, I pray that each one of us, in some measure, would turn our attention and focus on you. As we sing together, as our hearts are united around the words and the music, that you would be pleased and you would be honored. And then as we study the word, Father, we pray again that you would be honored and pleased, and also that you would be working, that the Holy Spirit would move in our hearts, convict us. And we will give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Would you stand with us as we begin our service worshiping the Lord?
Let us bow at his feet. Too. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges, he took the humble position of a slave, and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
You came to the world you created, trading your crown for a cross. You willingly died, your innocent life paid the cost. Counting your status as nothing, the King of all kings came to serve. Thank you.
desire. We need to look more like Jesus. Father, I just pray that as we have worshiped you through singing, now we worship you through the reading of your word, study of your word, God, would you open up our hearts? The world needs to see Jesus. Would you make us look more like him? Would you sing this with us one more time?
If more of you means less of me, take everything. Yes, all of you is all
of me. Take you can be seated. Wow, wasn't that great? Boy, what a way to start a week. First day of the week, starting with worship. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it so much. Well, we're going to introduce some concepts this morning and look at 2 Corinthians as we launch our Pentecost offering. And Pentecost Sunday is May 19th. And I don't know why that's this. You know, sometimes you work on slides The hard thing is they only get used once because we never reuse slides, it seems, but this was an opportunity to reuse the slide, and I forgot to change the 3 to a 4, but it really is 2024, and we do this every year, and I'm going to start talking about the Timothy offering, about this campaign in an unusual way, and I'm going to mention something at the beginning that probably will sound like the worst way to start talking about raising money for a project. But I hope you'll see that it's the right way. And I hope that this will be our best year ever. Back a few months ago, Pastor Lyle and I, along with the deacons, spent time praying and discussing the Pentecost offering for 2024 for the Timothy Initiative. And the question we were asking was, should we do it this year? Or skip a year? And the reason is that we have a lot of property needs at our church. We took the winter, the leadership council, to evaluate the needs of our property. We'll be rolling this information out to you in a couple months. Our facilities are about 60 years old. The youth center is about 50 years old. And the needs total in the hundreds of thousands, and not just a couple hundreds of thousands. We believe that, especially our youth center, but our entire property, that God has given us an opportunity to bless our community with the use of our facility. And over the last year, we've had so many affirmations that this is a God thing. Over 400 people in our community have key cards to get into our fitness center. We have weeks of a couple hundred people using our facility each week. Our town right now is about 6 months into an 18-month project working on a comprehensive plan. It's a 20-year plan covering the full range of everything that has to do with from how big the pipes are for the water and sewage and health of the lake, youth, recreation, the whole gamut. And Pastor Lyle and I actually got invited to be a part of the primary team. In multiple conversations and on multiple subgroups, Mountainside came up as our property being the answer to so many needs that our community has, especially in the area of youth, of recreation, and health. And so as we have been considering starting a nonprofit to go after funds that aren't available to a church, the community, people in the community have said, you know, we write grants, you know, we award grants. Is there any way that Mountainside would ever consider having a nonprofit that was not a church so that money could be given or we could help look for grants? And so there's just been so many things. But most of all, what has been happening over the past year and a half, is we have experienced people in our community coming to us for answers to their needs. We've had many opportunities to have gospel conversations with people that I don't think would have happened had there not been this sense between the town and Mountainside of our partnership. So, in the shadow of the fact that in a few months we're going to launch a capital campaign, we're going to wait for the snowbirds to get back. They're all coming back in the next month or two. So some of you may want to come Saturday night because it's going to really fill out. But anyway, so in the shadow of a capital campaign, do we launch a Pentecost offering? Do we ask the church family to give sacrificially to a project that is different from our great need? Do we ask our church family to give sacrificially to reach with the gospel into places where missionaries cannot go? And we know you, how you would answer, because we're you. We sit on that leadership council, and we knew that your answer would be absolutely that the gospel is our priority. And so that's what this year is going to be about, our Pentecost offering. And on the heels of our Pentecost offering, we're going to talk about the needs that we have in our community. And it will maybe be a few months or a year project. We have some people that are helping us in our church family that are good at this kind of thing. And so you'll be hearing more about that. But we wanted you to know up front that we believe that God wants us to go forward with the Pentecost offering. So I grew up in a church before my family moved to Spring Lake when I was 15 that was very mission-minded. It just was a part of the fact. I remember as a child that the children's programs in July would have Christmas in July, and we'd set up a Christmas tree, and we would all give money to send to the missionaries in July so they would have their presents by Christmas. And I remember, you know, it was before you could wire money, all this kind of stuff. It was snail mail all the way to wherever our missionaries were. Missionary conferences, and it just was a great time. The church I pastored in New Jersey was extremely mission-minded. We actually had an internship program for missionaries. That church was sending a missionary couple out almost every year, at least for my last 5 or 6 years there. We were sending a couple out of the mission field. We'd actually began to adapt a policy of only supporting people from our ministry because it was just becoming too much. Well, then I come to Mountainside, and I don't even know what adjective to use to describe Mountainside. So I'm going to illustrate it. So put your Bible to the side. I'm going to ask you to stand and answer to a few of these questions. So first question. No, everybody sit down. You answer the question if this is true about you. Have you ever been on a mission trip? Stand up. Now look around. People in the back don't have to look around. There are few churches in the world that would have those kind of numbers. Okay, sit down. Stand up if you have a close friend or relative that is a missionary. Amazing, isn't it? Okay, sit down. One more question. Now you can have ice cream for lunch. Stand up if you support missionaries outside of the church missionaries. In other words, you individually send money to support missionaries. Stand up. And again, isn't that amazing? I know of a couple missionaries. You can sit down now. I know of a couple missionaries who've said to me, my greatest, my biggest supporter or second biggest supporter is the church of Mountainside, and they weren't on our mission team family. In other words, individuals in the church were supporting them to a degree. So as I talked to Dale Hummel, who's coming here next week to speak for TTI, I said to him, you don't have to convince us about missions. If the statistics of who we are is mind-blowing. And so the whole point of talking about missions is not to motivate the mass of the church. There are some that this is a new thing, talking about missions. But we've all grown up, many of us, with this idea of missions and meeting missionaries, and many of you are Bible Institute students, so I don't know the kind of churches you came from, but you're sure getting a lot about missions at Word of Life. So, and in fact, Word of Life has, as of yesterday, 1,600 missionaries serving in 83 countries. It's probably 1,601 today, right? And so if you work for Word of Life, or you're connected to Word of Life, or you came to this area because of Word of Life, or you're a student at Word of Life, you understand. You have a world vision. And so the question is, why TTI? And first, let's just review God's plan for the church real quickly. In Acts 1:8, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere. So the good news of the gospel is to go everywhere. It starts locally in Jerusalem, through Judea, so Screen Lake, Essex County. Samaria would be a different culture, and the uttermost parts of the earth, or the ends of the earth, to all of the world. The Old Testament is a missionary book as well. It's not as obvious. For example, Jonah is a missionary book. The beginning promise to Abraham was that all the nations of the earth would be blessed. Israel failed in their task to reach the world, and the task has been given to the church of reaching the world with the gospel. And the question is how are we doing? And it's a tough one to answer, because the population of our earth is growing at such a rate. And there are many challenges that we face. People have to go, and people have to send. Romans 10:13-15 says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? How can they believe in him if they've never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? That's why the scriptures say, how beautiful are the feet of the messengers who bring good news. There are goers and there are senders. Now, we're all to be witnesses. We understand that. Harry Baalbeck's Be a Missionary is playing in my head right now. It will probably play the rest of the day as an earworm. But anyway, so we're all called to be goers to a sense, but when people go out of their culture, they need senders. David Nelms, who's the founder of TTI, says often, and Pastor Lyle and I have gone to the fundraising conference all but last year, and he says something like this: I have been in ministry for 50 years, and I have tried to find a way to do ministry without money. And it takes money to do ministry. It takes money to send missionaries. Sending is not just giving. Sending is praying. Sending is supporting. Sending is encouraging. Sending is visiting. And so there are so many ways that a sender enters into. Look at Paul's request for prayer. He even uses the words like to strain or to work hard at prayer. And so it's not just throw up a, just to say and bless the missionaries in the cornfields. My little brother said at the dinner table, because we were praying for the missionaries in the cornfields, and he was hearing cornfields. And so, and of course, as the big brother, I'm like, wow, he's got to stop that. And my parents are thinking it's amazing. But you know how that goes. There are other great challenges to missions in the world today, to going everywhere. There are closed countries where there are no missionaries. There are countries where evangelism is even outlawed. In other words, in Nepal, it is a law that if you shared your faith, witness to somebody with the idea of converting them, that you can be thrown into prison. Dr. Paul Weaver goes to Egypt to teach in an Egypt Bible Institute. I think that's the name of something like that. They cannot accept students who have been converted, first-generation Christians, because their papers say that they are Muslim. And they would be an illegal school if they had a student who was technically to the government a Muslim. That is a difficult thing to deal with. There are countries that are open, but only partially. India, our missionaries' assignments are down in the southwestern part, Kailal section of India. It is very Christian there. But as you go north and east, you start to find increased persecution, to where as you approach Nepal and Asia, you start to have places where it might be legal in the country, but it's not legal there. And you'll be persecuted for your faith. When we send missionaries from our culture, they go to all the open places. We can't send a missionary to a closed place. And so there are gaps. And where are the gaps? And let me just real quickly talk about people groups. If you want to put up the next slide, there are so many. How many people groups are in the world? Some say 24,000, some say 17,000, some say 11,000, 13,000. Which number is correct? They can't all be correct. And sometimes they all are correct depending upon how you divide a people group. And back in 1982 at Lausanne, for evangelism purposes, this is their definition, a people group is the largest group within which the gospel can spread as a church planting movement without encountering barriers of understanding and acceptance. That there are people who are bringing the gospel that are just like me. There is no barrier. So a missionary going in to a people group, he is from another people group. Notice it's not just language. It could be a caste system. It could be religious tradition. It could be a location. It could be common histories and tradition, cultural distinctions. For example, in the nation of India, there are 450 ethno-linguistic people, 450 different languages. So there are 450 people groups just based on language. There are over 2,500 ethnic people groups when caste, religion, and cultural factors are factored in. 2,500 people groups that it takes somebody outside of the people group to go in for the gospel to be planted there. The Bible seems to describe this in heaven. Revelation 7, 9 through 10 sounds a lot like defining people groups. After this, I saw a vast crowd, too great to count, from every nation and tribe and people and language. There are those differences that divide people. Standing in front, notice they're not divided here. Standing in front of the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes, held palm branches in their hand, and they were shouting with a great roar, "Salvation comes from our God who sits on the throne and under the Lamb." Then we have the category of unreached people group. An unreached people group is a place where less than 2% of the population follows Jesus. And we hold to a strict definition of what that means. There are then two subcategories. There is the unengaged unreached people group. Unengaged means there is no gospel effort. There is no likely no believer, no Bible, no body of Christ, no church presence, and nobody is yet trying to establish a church among them. Some groups do not even have a single believer. Then there are unengaged unreached people groups. These are places like Japan. Japan has less than 2% followers of Jesus in their population, but they have Japanese Bible, they have Japanese churches, so they are engaged. Quebec, just 100 miles north of us, is an unreached people group, less than 2%. In fact, fewer Christians per capita in Quebec than in Tokyo, Japan. Let that sink in for a minute. And there's a history of that, and we're actually trying to arrange for a pastor in Montreal or a pastor in Quebec to come down, and in one of these weeks, and it'll happen this year, to just take a few minutes in our morning service and explain the challenges of that. Back in the 60s and 70s, they went from being a religious nation to a secular nation, and they threw off religion with a vengeance, a hatred, and the pastors were aging out. Pastors are 60s and 70s, but there is a whole group of young pastors now that their goal is singular. They want to flip Quebec off the unreached people group. But they will have to more than double the number of Christians in that province. Most of the unreached people groups are in the 1040 window. 1040 window is 10 degrees north to 10 degrees north latitude to 40 degrees north latitude. And it comes in that area that you see in red. We include a few adjacent countries like Kazakhstan. It's basically 5 million people, 5 billion people that live in that area. 8,949 distinct people groups. Let me go on to the next thing. Here are some of the statistics. 69 nations in that group, 2/3 of the world's population, 85% of the poorest in the world, primarily Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, and some would add animism. 45 of the 50 most persecuted nations that persecute believers are in that group. 60% live in an unreached people group. You can't go there. We can't send there. Word of Life, their secret sauce is the fact that they have missionaries from many different nations. That was a question I should have asked yesterday when I sent a text to Chris Stout, is how many missionaries are from how many nations? Because Word of Life can go to places that Americans can't go because they have missionaries from South America and missionaries from Asian countries. But many of these countries, you can't get a visa, you can't work in ministry legally, you won't be accepted by the culture, you won't understand the culture, and they won't understand you, and there is a huge financial cost to send a missionary. We have a missionary couple that are in Vietnam. It takes years to learn the language and to learn the culture. It is a very challenging task for a missionary to go cross culture, and some are harder than others. So here's the reason for TTI. And if you go to the slide that starts with 400, I took some slides out from last night. I'm not sure if that's the next one. My notes aren't quite caught up with where I changed the message from last night. $400 plants a church in TTI, which seems ridiculous when you first hear it. How does $400 support a missionary? And next week, Dr. Hummel or Mr. Hummel will share more about the specifics of TTI. But with TTI, there are no salaries. Church planters are tent makers. There's no sanctuaries. They meet wherever they can. Many times they have to meet in secret. Sometimes they meet outside. There are no seminaries. TTI is a training program to train pastors over a period of time to lead a congregation, to be a step ahead of them in teaching them, but to also be training people in the church to go out and reach people and establish their own. And so let me sum up this section with the fact that we are raising money for the Timothy Initiative. We'll be reminding you of this every week. But after next week, we're going to actually begin a study of 1 Peter, and that will take us through the summer. But I want to take the second half of this message and look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So if you take your Bibles and turn there, we'll have the words up, the scripture up for you. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 3, speak about eternity. For we know that when this earthly tent we live in is taken down, that is when we die and leave this earthly body, we have a house in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God himself and not by human hands. We grow weary in our present bodies, and we long to put on heavenly bodies like new clothing. For we will put on heavenly bodies. We will not be spirits without bodies. I asked the question recently to somebody, how do you picture yourself in heaven? And, we're not going to be spirits. We're going to have real bodies. So the chapter begins with the promise of heaven. that when we die, we have a home in heaven. We have a body made by God himself, like an emphasis. It's not human hands. Again, the emphasis that this is God doing this. It's not a spirit without a body. But we grow weary here. Anybody weary? Weary comes as you get older, too. Somebody posted last week about jumping off the cliffs at Split Rock. And they were like 20, 22. And I wrote, I did that too, believe it or not. Because who would believe that I jumped off cliffs, right? But it was 50 years ago that I jumped off the cliff. And my girlfriend asked me to promise that I would never do that again. To which I said, I can't promise that. I did not promise that. I stand there sometimes at Split Rock, and I still have that urge to jump off. I know I wouldn't make it. I wish I'd known the last time was the last time. You know that idea? You know, at one point, I never went back to Split Rock and put on a bathing suit and jumped in the cliffs. We used to jump in the cliffs all the way down through the canyon. Just so much fun. It would be insane for me to even think about doing that now. As you get older, things change. I remember when I came here to Mountainside, Bob Brown and Wayne Lewis had just turned 60, and Wayne said it really hurt his feelings to turn 60. It hurt my feelings, too, when I turned 60. And then Wayne said, wait till 70. So we're in this life, and heaven is where all the things are going to be fixed. Verse 4. We are in this life. While we live in these earthly bodies, we groan and sigh. It's not that we want to die and get rid of these bodies to close. We don't have a death wish, but rather we want to put on these new bodies so that these dying bodies, and I love this phrase, will be swallowed up by life. What a picture that God has prepared us for this. And the guarantee is by the Holy Spirit. God gave us the Holy Spirit as a promise. Ephesians 1 says we are placed in Christ and sealed with the Holy Spirit, and that he is the promise, in a sense, the promissory note, the down payment, the deposit, the assurance that what God has planned will be ours. But we groan and sigh. You know, as I'm preparing this, I'm thinking about people in the church family. You know, and there's cancer, and there's brain issues, and there's autoimmune disease, and there's all kinds of issues that we face, some for a lifetime. Today, 21 years ago today, my secretary, my wife's best friend, died at 38. And we only knew that she had a brain tumor for 3 months. So on the April 7th, on my calendar, it says every year, remember Debbie. 2003. And so I'm aware of this. In fact, the song, I Can Only Imagine, had just come out, and her son, we had the kids pick songs for a funeral, picked I Can Only Imagine. And so every time I hear that song, I picture Debbie before the throne of God. And it breaks my heart. She was the kind of person that laughed at everything, even when she wasn't supposed to, which cracks me up to even remember, like, she had no problem laughing at the most inappropriate times. She was a wonderful, wonderful person. But she's not groaning anymore. You know, she never experienced so much, but what she experienced in heaven is so much better. We know that. And it's not that we want to leave all of this, but we just have in the back of our mind, we say it every time somebody dies, don't we? We say, I'm glad their suffering is over. I'm glad they're seeing the face of Jesus and all of these things, and they're all true. And so, while in this life, verses 6 through 9, we are always confident, even though we long to live in bodies, we are not at home with the Lord. And then such an important verse, we live by believing, not by seeing. Not by sight. And so many times we're tempted to say, God told me this. And I flinch a little bit with that because I believe the best I can say is I believe that God led me this way. But I don't get to see. You know, seeing is where I can walk out of this church by looking and I know there's an open lane. Faith has a b- bit of mystery. I can only know what God has told me in his word. And so we walk by faith. But we know that the promises of God are sure. But there's a mystery. I've sat down with a number of people over the years. People have been Christians for 30, 40, 50 years, even some longer, as they're facing death. And they'll say something like this: I'm not afraid of death. I'm afraid of dying. There's a mystery to what happens. That passage is a fearful thing. We don't know how that all works. Will they suffer? Will this or will that? But we trust God, that God will do whatever it is, will call me to whatever is his desire for me to glorify by walking that path. We're confident that we'd rather be away from these earthly bodies, for then we will be at home with the Lord. So whether we are here in the body or away from this body, our goal is to please him. When you come to Christ, you have a goal that lasts for eternity. Whether you're here or there, is to please God. When you wake up in the morning, your early thoughts in the day should be, I want to please God. When you go to the Word, we go to the Word because that's the sure thing. His Word will not pass away, because it instructs us in how to please God. And that's the goal. That's what we prayed this morning, that when we sing together, that God would find it pleasing. That when we walk through the day, when we live in our homes, or we are students, or grandparents, or parents, or single, or wherever our lot is, wherever we are, that we would live a life pleasing with the place that he's placed us. Then comes the reality check, judgment seat. For we must all stand before Christ to be judged. We will receive whatever we deserve for the good or the evil done in our earthly bodies. Have you ever had an experience, especially as you get older, you start to have more of these, where there's a certain sense of, I can't believe I'm here. I can't believe I'm doing this. I can't believe that this is, almost that this is real. It's one of those moments that is life-changing. Ruthie and I got married, and we stood right here on this platform. And I remember that day, like from the moment I woke up, it's like, man, this is really happening. You know, my dad woke me up and said, I think it's time to get up. You know, today's your wedding day. And wow. And standing here was like, man. And then getting in a car and driving, we dated 5 years. And all of a sudden we're driving to live the rest of our life away from everybody. It was like, is this real? I remember in 1985 when Ashley was born, my first child, and there in the room holding her, and I'm a dad. And how life-changing that was. How everything, almost life seemed to freeze at that moment. A reality check. When I worked in business for 15 years, when I gave my notice that I was going to become a pastor at the church I was attending. I worked a four-month exit, so we were in the middle of development, and we wanted to be sure that everything was covered. So I think I worked from like February through June or July, I forget exactly. But when I got in the car, after I said goodbye to my boss, as I said goodbye to him, I got really choked up because we had worked so closely together. And I remember going out and getting the car and driving across the Ben Franklin Bridge to go over to New Jersey, and realizing that for 6 years almost, I had come across that bridge on the train or a car every day. And this was my last time. I was driving. I have a picture that a photographer took, and it's a picture of that bridge with the train going over and the buildings to just sort of represent that part of my life, the reality. Now, I say all of that for this. When you come to the judgment seat of Christ, it will be that real, and it will be even more real. Everyone in this room that's trusted Christ as our Savior is going to stand before Christ to give an account. Verse 11 really locks in the magnitude of this. We understand our fearful responsibility to the Lord. We work hard to persuade others. God knows we are sincere, and I hope you know this too. There is a magnitude about that moment that will be unmatched by anything that I've experienced in life or you've experienced. It'll be bigger than my wedding and bigger than becoming a dad and bigger than going to ministry, bigger than anything and everything combined. I will stand before Jesus, my Lord and Savior, to give an account, and you will too. I think about that when I prepare my messages. I think about you, that I have an influence on how that day goes for you. I've thought about that with each of my children as they're growing up, that I will be a part of their day that day. Now, you're going to make choices, and I'm going to make choices, and my kids make choices, and all of those kinds of things. It's not that I'm totally responsible, but am I influencing in a proper way? Now, what we're going to talk about is hinted to in this verse, to persuade others. Everyone is going to stand before God. I serve on three committees in town that meet every month, and I serve on one that meets quarterly. Two of them, I'm the secretary, actually three of them. I think about that every meeting. I look around the room, and I think each one of them are going to stand before God. I go to basketball game. I'm taking my grandson to Monster Jam on Saturday. It's just something that I've always done. I look around the stadium and I realize every person here is going to stand before God to give an accounting. That's a fearful thing. Fearful not in that we are to be scared of standing before Jesus, but fearful in the magnitude of it. In verses 12 and 13, Paul reminds the Christians of his sincerity. I'm going to skip those verses for time because he does that throughout the book of 2 Corinthians. But now we talk about Christ's love. And that should say Christ's love, not judgment seat. Either way, Christ's love controls us. Since we believe that Christ died for all, that everyone I'll see on Saturday, everyone I see in town, every person that waits on me in Tops, every waiter or waitress that waits on me in the restaurants in town, every person I pass on the streets, that Christ died for all. We also believe that we have died to our old life. So let me separate these two for a second. I've died to my old life. When we think of the magnitude of pleasing God, sometimes I say, God, why did you make me so weak? Why did you make me so easily distracted? Why couldn't you just make me stronger? Couldn't you just make me more of this, more of that? And 2 Peter says, God has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness. God's answer is right there in 2 Peter. I've given you all you need. I haven't left you without. I've given you, you've died with Christ and you've risen to the new life with Christ. Romans 6. The Holy Spirit has come to dwell in you, to guide you. You live in a community of believers who encourage you, and you disciple and they disciple you. I mean, there is so much that God has done. He's done everything necessary for me to live. And the only excuse is that when I choose not to, it's because I chose. I'm not too weak. And that's just an excuse for me to put the blame back on God, like Adam and Eve. And God says, no, I've given you everything you need. And so we've died to all of that. And he who believes that we died to our old life, he died for everyone so that those who receive this new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ who died and raised and was raised for them. Verse 16. So we stop evaluating others from a human point of view. When we look in the face of someone who's waiting on us, we see they we see beyond the humanity of this moment, that we see eternity is their reality as well. At one time, we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. How differently we know him now. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. There again is that provision. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. And now our task of reconciliation. And this is the gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. Reconciliation means that people are at odds. At the fall of Adam and Eve, humanity became at odds with God. Reconciliation means to restore an individual back to a right relationship with God. And Paul is saying that has happened for you, and now God is giving us the task, the ministry of reconciliation. That's our job. That's part of living the Christian life, is in the business of reconciliation. What an amazing thing to even think about, is seeing people be restored to a right relationship with God. So, verse 20, we are Christ's ambassadors. I don't have time to go down this path, so I'm just going to make a statement. I see today a movement of angry Christians. They're fed up with this, and they're fed up with that, and they're going to fight their way out of it. When you're an ambassador, it's no longer you. If the government, if the President of the United States asked me to be an ambassador to some other country, the understanding is that when I live in the other country, that I'm not David Peterson, I'm the United States of America. And what I do is what America does. I represent America as an ambassador. So if we're ambassadors, we live a life that is representative of Jesus Christ. That when people see, they don't understand that David Peterson is not David Peterson, but what really is happening is I need to be living the Christ-like life. Because, look at this, God is making his appeal through us. Stop and think about that. God has ordained that his appeal to those unbelievers in your life is through you. We speak for Christ when we say, come back to God. That is so profound. That's what this offering is about, is going into those places where we can't go and we can't send. And so through the movement there with nationals, training nationals, and that's why the $400 goes so far. Verse 21 sums it up. For God made Christ who never sinned to be the offering for our sins so that we could be made right with God through Christ. And the final summation is that when Jesus Christ went to the cross, and we've just passed a month of focusing on the suffering of Christ, that our sin was laid at him. When you go to stand before Jesus, your sins have been paid for at the cross. And we've been given his righteousness. And people need to hear that. There's a lot of brokenness. A lot of brokenness. A lot of sorrow. A lot of hopelessness. In our world today, we have the answer. Do you ever think about that when you sit in a crowd, that you got the answer? And that you're an ambassador. You're there to represent Jesus Christ. What a privilege. And so this offering is just that we provide training and launching for people in these unreached people groups so that they can go. So the beauty of this is, in my mind, we stopped supporting monthly TTI. And so our missionary support, our regular monthly support, is for missionaries that we send to places where they can go. The TTI offering goes into those gaps where missionaries can't go. And I just love that idea. John Piper wrote in a, he wrote a great mission book back 30 plus years ago. Missions exist because worship doesn't. In that 1040 window, there's very little worship of our God. And missions exist so that worshipers will be raised up. Let's pray. Father, thank you. We're overwhelmed by the idea that we are your ambassadors, that you have given the gospel message to us, that you plead with people through us. God, I pray for us here today that the reality check of the judgment seat of Christ would be a motivation. The fact that you have equipped us to life and godliness would be a motivation. The fact that we're ambassadors would be a motivation. The fact that the Holy Spirit works along with us, convicting the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment, would be a motivation. God, help us to see people through your eyes. And we'll give you all praise and glory as we go through this offering. Pentecost Sunday, we pray that you would amaze us. In Jesus' name, amen. As we come to a time of communion, if you want to take up your cups, we always begin communion by going to 1 Corinthians 11. Or usually, last time I used the Mark passage. Corinthians gives a warning about taking communion in an unworthy manner. And an unworthy manner would be, first of all, not being a believer. Nobody's watching whether you open or don't open. The second way that an unworthy manner is just to think, I'm worthy. When we examine ourselves, we recognize our unworthiness, even as a believer. I can prepare for communion and get my heart right and all of those kinds of things, but I have to recognize that my sufficiency, my provision, that everything that I have is because of Christ. And so meditation on open myself to God reminds me that my sufficiency is in Jesus Christ. And third would be if there's rebellion in your heart. In other words, as you come before the Lord, you realize that there's something you're going to do today that you shouldn't do. Or there's something that you have between you and someone that shouldn't be. There are things that you are not going to deal with. That would be an unworthy manner. But Paul writes, in examining yourself, you are to take. And so the examination is to bring myself before the Lord, and maybe it's a commitment to take care of this or whatever it is, however you work that out with the Lord. But we're just not to open this up and do it. It is to be a solemn time of focusing on the broken body and the shed blood of Christ, which is our sufficiency. So, let me read Psalm 139, and let's go to prayer, and then we'll continue with an attitude of prayer. And so as you bow your heads or close your eyes or however you want to come before the Lord, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you, and lead me in the path of everlasting life. God, forgive me for the times that I offend you. We have no hope apart from Jesus Christ and the provision of the Holy Spirit and the eternal word, your love for us. And so the only standing that we have is based on the finished work of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name. Paul continues, for I pass on to you what I received from the Lord Jesus himself. On the night in which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and gave thanks for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us eat together. In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us drink. O God, as we have studied today, we groan and are weary in this life. There are so many things wrong around us and so many things wrong in us. We long for the peace and the clarity and the wholeness of heaven. And so we say with saints that have prayed since Jesus ascended into heaven, "Come quickly, Lord Jesus." In Jesus' name, amen.
Pastor Dave, would you guys stand with us again as we close out our service? We're going to be singing a song that's new for us as a church family. We've never done this one here before, but I hope that you would just reflect on the words. The tie-in's so great to what Pastor Dave was saying today about Jesus being our all-sufficient merit. Right, the last verse that Pastor Dave read during his sermon was, "He made the one who did not know sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Right? We get his righteous merit. We can't earn it. So as we sing this song, if you know it, sing it out loud. Declare this truth. If you don't know it, just reflect on the words. This is the truth over our souls this morning. Let's sing it together.
Shining light in the sun.
Well, that's a great song. We need to sing that more. Let's sing that often. Well, let's go out remembering that we're ambassadors, that God is making his plea through us. Be reconciled to God. You're dismissed. Hey, fun to see you playing.